buried deep under these bone dry high plains in a covert section of a massively hardened centrifuge facility, a team is hard at work. They are members of a breakaway faction of the country's security forces, and they are busy enriching 40 kilograms of uranium. By July 3rd, they achieve their target of 90% enrichment, and then transfer the uranium to a nearby secret lab, where another team of technicians assembles it into a crude nuclear bomb. On August 31, they finish their work. They put the bomb in a packing crate labeled agricultural equipment and transport it to a nearby airfield where it is stored in a warehouse. 2 weeks later, it is removed and loaded onto an aircraft with civilian air cargo markings. It flies to Dubai, where the crate is transferred, along with other goods and equipment, to a global air transport freighter. Destination, Washington, D.C. The plane lands at Washington's Dulles International Airport at 2:47 a.m. on September the 15th. By late afternoon, the crate is delivered to a warehouse in the southeast part of the district. Then, before daybreak, on September the 17th, the bomb is removed from the crate and loaded onto a delivery truck. Several hours later, an American citizen eases the truck out into traffic. She drives it to a location on Pennsylvania Avenue, midway between the White House and the Capitol Building. At 11:09 a.m., she stops in the middle of traffic, climbs down onto the street, and triggers the detonator. The bomb explodes with a power of 15 kilotons. There are more than 80,000 instant deaths, including the president, the vice president, the speaker of the House, and the 320 members of Congress present when the bomb goes off. There are also...
Okay, maybe that wasn't quite what you expected. I would like to tell you all a story. This story, I think, kind of encapsulates my experience over the past 4 years as a person who spent about 25 years making commercial games and then entered what we might call the Games for Change or Serious Game world. And what would happen is pretty often I'd be called into some meeting somewhere with people I've never heard of and introduced as, you know, that game guy. And one day, a little over a year ago, I got called into just such a meeting. And it was with these folks, some of whom I had heard of and a couple of them I hadn't. I thought, okay, that's fine. They seemed friendly. A couple of them had interesting accents. And so let's talk. And they introduced themselves. And they were all experts in nuclear security issues. And they said, you know, can you make us a game? And I said, actually, this problem's already solved. There is a game. It's called DEFCON, right? Haven't you seen it? This game is excellent. And they're like, no, we know that game. Actually, yeah, you're right. It's a really good game, and it's totally actually not what we're looking for. And in fact, DEFCON's kind of an example of the problem, not the solution. And I thought, well, that's odd. I was a child of the Cold War, and I remembered what this was like. Missile command, right? They said, no, it's different now. That was scary, and we honor your fear, but actually it's worse now. Since especially the collapse of the Soviet Union, there is a tremendous amount of fissionable material kind of out there, and a lot of it we don't actually know where it is. And there's a lot of people that would like to have it and might do all kinds of really bad things with it. Did you know that? I said, I did not know that. You know, okay, let's try. And so we did a little workshop, and I always started these workshops with some kind of a, okay, this is game design thing in about 30 minutes, so let's make it 30 seconds, because game design is easy, right? and it goes something like games are loops, the loops have state, and then you take an action, that action has an effect. I know there's a certain group of students here who have seen all this before. The systems that we implemented have affordances, actions, and feedbacks, and then we have verbs that affect the system. Right, cool, we're done, let's go make a game. And, except, okay, it's a little harder than that, but we'll get back to that in a second. We broke into a couple of groups, these experts and I, and they decided to put together some game ideas. You know, helping them through their ideas, getting the verbs, getting the loops, getting the state. And the winning pitch, we actually had them pitch to our group at Glass Lab, which is where I was working at the time. Winning a pitch was something called Trinity. Okay, obviously named after the original Manhattan Project. And their pitch was, the only way to prove a point is to prove the point. It goes a little something like this. You're someone with a lot of money. Let's say you're a really pissed off Silicon Valley entrepreneur, and you're really upset that no one's taking the nuclear threat seriously. I know how to solve this. I will put together a bomb, and I'll explode it, but not on Pennsylvania Avenue. I'll explode it just a few miles off the coast of DC. That should get everyone's attention. And it turns out you can do this if you have enough money. Today. And they pitched that to us, and they walked us through the process of how you would do it and how you could turn that into sort of a, oh, I don't know, point-and-click adventure. It could be really interesting, right? And we said, actually, holy shit. and kind of nobody talked to each other for the rest of the day. And that concluded one of the strangest days of my life. And that story inspired me to pitch this talk. Because as a person coming from the games world, from the commercial games world, I was inspired, and I obviously was already doing this, but I was really thinking, man, more people should get involved with this. More people should know that there are things that we are being asked to look into. So let's talk more about that. This was kind of what was interesting. Usually when I talk to this with, like, let's say, government officials or educators, they kind of go like, okay, yep, games, yep, we know that. There's a story, or like you click on stuff, or definitely you shoot people in the face. But they didn't really have a good sense of it. But this group actually had a far better sense of it. They understood it really quickly, and I thought that's interesting. And I had to think about that much later. And really, if you think about this, if we define games as verbs acting on a system, this is what it means to be an activist. They said, right, the current state is what we don't like. The system is what we know affects it. The verbs are the change we're trying to create. Got it. So I thought that's really cool. And then that makes me think, a lot of you in this room also get that. And maybe this medium is even better suited than we would think for this kind of action. Now, when they do pitch something to me, it usually came down to this. Engagement, right? Engagement. We know that people play games for hours and hours and hours, and we want all that eyeballs. Yeah, okay, it's true. I don't think it's the best argument. Another is, we know that we reach a very, very large proportion of the market, especially young people. Also true. Also, in my view, not the best reason that games are well-suited to this. Video games can be surprisingly subversive. I don't know if anyone has played any of the work of Paolo Pedicini or Mol Industria. It's incredibly subversive stuff and fantastic, and really makes you think in a way that just some sort of video or linear media kind of can't. And there's more. Generally speaking, when we communicate with each other, we use stories. Stories are powerful. Stories are how we remember things, are how we communicate with one another. But they have a problem. And that is, stories are reductive. A narrative of a thing tells you only one way that thing can be or how it happened. I like to think of it as the most effective form of data compression in the world. And when you have a situation of complexity, the story can only show us one aspect of that complexity. If the story says, well, that's complicated, then that's also called a bad story. Games, however, are different. Games operate in complexity. It is the complexity of games that makes them special. It's that area of complexity that makes games a new medium that is unlike any that came before. But it's hard. Setting up these systems is hard. And when people have tried to do this, and we've played maybe some of these attempts, they often go awry. And this is why I was in the room that day, because I'm this person who has done it before. Really, game design is not a 30-minute activity. It's probably not a 30-second activity. It's a 10,000-hour activity, which means that if we're going to do this effectively, it needs to be people that have done it for those 10,000 hours. And the smart people are learning that who they want to talk to is you. And some of them actually are in the audience today. I know because they've been talking to me over the last 3 days. So what do I think is the outcome of all this? Well, some of us remember this. This is the consumerist's worst company in America. This would be the year that EA actually dropped off the chart. It got a very favorable matchup. But what was interesting about 2014 was not this corner, actually. It was this corner. I saw that and I went, SeaWorld, that's weird. That's family entertainment. Why would they be in the worst company of America lists? Why did they almost win? I mean, Comcast, that's not fair. But they almost won. And of course, the reason they almost won was this. It was a movie, a documentary film called Blackfish. It was a story. It was a story of a particular killer whale named Tilikum. And by the way, Tilikum is dying, for those that saw this. He's dying as of the last couple weeks. And it was very moving. And it had quite a profound effect on SeaWorld. SeaWorld actually, this morning, announced that they are no longer going to have killer whales in their show in San Diego. I had nothing to do with that. This is to emphasize the power of this kind of medium. This got recently exposed. They had planted spies in the activist organizations that were protesting against them. SeaWorld folks are bad people, and they got brought down by this documentary. But it's hard, and sometimes it doesn't work. I personally think that An Inconvenient Truth, the book and the movie, were both extremely well done. This is the drama moment of the film, if you've seen it, with the hockey stick and the scissors lift. And guess what? That did not work. Since that was released, more people don't believe global warming is real than before. And what I'd like to do also is call attention to the picture on the right. That's James Inhofe, who now chairs the Senate Committee on Science, telling a story that if there's a snowball in his hand that he got off the street in Washington, D.C., global warming must not be real on the floor of the Senate. Maybe that's a little complicated for such a narrative, and maybe a game could do it better. Maybe it couldn't, I don't know, but I sure think it's worth a try. There are other issues out there, too, that I think of as being complex, and where understanding the complexity of the issue might be the thing that can change the way people think of it. Maybe they can change their behavior. Here's one. The majority of the growth in antibiotic resistance comes from two places. One is the fact that antibiotics are way over-prescribed. It's not going to help your flu, ever. The other is people don't take the full course of their antibiotics. Who knew this, that you have to take the full course of your antibiotics? Yeah, bullshit. If you don't take the whole thing, you get a new strain that's actually slightly stronger. And people keep doing that, and then they pass it on to someone else. And next thing you know, you've got a resistant bacterium out there. And the only way you can really understand why this happens is understanding how evolution works. which probably James Inhofe is not the best resource for that. A game could show that really nicely. This is where I was spending a few years in education. This report came out last year. It was not good news in terms of the level of competence of math in our schools. And by the way, Common Core is not the problem. If I can soapbox for just a moment, Common Core is part of the solution, but we'll move on. This is a really interesting map. The EPA just released recently this new tool, and this is called Data That's Political. On the left, that allows you to show the correlation between poverty and pollution. That's Manhattan. And you can pretty much go anywhere in the United States and see this happen. You can make that little GIF. When we made SimCity EDU and took it into schools, and we did that at Glass Lab, thanks, I think I saw Stone back there. Thank you, Stone, for making that happen. Quick story. We had a teacher who used SimCity EDU in her class, and it was called SimCity EDU Pollution Challenge. And the idea was that kids learn to balance the trade-offs between pollution and energy. But something else happened. One of the students came up to this teacher and said, "Now, when I play this game, what I'm doing is zoning, right?" And the student, teacher said, "Yes." Student says, "Is that how they really do it in the real world?" "Yeah, that's how they do it." "So that means that that factory that's right by my house, somebody made that zoning?" "Yeah, that's true." "Oh, man." This is a middle school kid who had never realized that a person made that decision. It didn't just happen. And SimCity actually taught this kid that thing. And that's profound. Or, back to our little starting moment. This guy, I'm not sure, I think he might be ex-KGB, they're not quite sure exactly who he is, sold a thermosized jug of real, highly enriched uranium to an undercover police officer for $330,000 last year, in November. He got caught, but this is scary stuff. This is like just a kind of a fun game prototype that I started to play around with. I think it's probably stupid and it's probably going to suck. But it's based on the doomsday clock from my era, and I wonder if there's some way of bridging that. So what should you do? Well, that's complicated. I want to first warn everybody, you're not going to get rich doing this. If you want to get rich, knock yourself out. Have fun. There are lots of ways to do that you're learning about here. If you want to make art even better, please do. So this is different. But here's a few resources. One is Games for Change. Games for Change, this organization, has both a conference, a website, they do lots of things, and they are the leading force in this space. And did anyone go to Colleen's talk yesterday? Fantastic talk. She gave a fantastic talk. As soon as it appears on the vault, if you're interested in this, go watch her talk. It was terrific. It was also a lot of fun. Games for Change, along with N Square, which I learned was not coincidence following the meeting I had with them, put up basically a grand challenge, $10,000 for the winning game design, to come up with something around nuclear security. They gave somebody $10,000 for that. How cool is that? They're doing it again. They're doing it for financial literacy. That's the one you see called Feed the Pig. And just a couple days ago, Games for Change announced their third grand challenge. This one's for climate. Again, $10,000 cash prize. Any and all of you can enter. Some other resources. Mark DeLora, who was, in case you don't know who Mark DeLora is, Mark was for several years our advocate in the White House. He worked for the Obama administration as the game czar after a long career including Nintendo, Sony, and lots of other places. He publishes this called the Level Up Report. It's fantastic. Gamesandlearning.org is a nice resource if you are interested in going into games for learning. I want to give a shout out to Aaron, my colleague at UC Santa Cruz, who runs the Beat the Dev fundraiser for the Sierra Club. Yes. I got another one of these funny phone calls about 3 weeks ago from this organization. They're called Project Everyone. You might know them as the people who run Comic Relief in the UK, or this thing called Red Nose Day, where people wear a red nose around to raise money for various charitable causes. And they would love to get into games. And I had a long conversation with them. And they actually shared this video with me, and this is, I will promise you, this is more uplifting than the last thing I showed you. But it's around the 17 UN goals. Who knows the 17 UN worldwide goals? Who knows they even exist? All right, we're doing better than average by far. This is 17 goals for a sustainable planet. They're a 15-year plan. We're on our second 15 years of this, folks. And nobody knows about it. And so their goal is to spread the word. The world leaders have signed on, but not the world population. How about that? So here's a little film they made, just to kind of get you all excited about the world goals. Despite what you hear in the American media, the world doesn't suck.
Oh, no, Wayne Gatling got away brilliantly. He's ahead of the field, and Usain Bolt has stopped! Usain Bolt has stopped at the 50-meter line!
Oh, that is a pity!
Five. Apollo, you're on course. 226 hours to the moon orbit.
Okay, thanks, Houston. But I think we'll be heading back now.
Come again?
Yeah, it was kind of fun. But I think halfway will do. Job done.
Not all linear media is bad. That's pretty good. So this is a group, they work with people like Usain Bolt, with like Coldplay gets totally involved in this stuff, and they want to work with game developers. They want to work with you guys. And they asked me if I would ask you to work with them. And we're going to talk about it. We're going to do a webinar April 13th. Follow this Twitter handle. We made a Facebook page for it. I would love for, I don't even know how we're going to figure out the technology on this, but for if we get all of you to show up and talk to this organization about how we can make a game that's as cool, that's as engaging, that's as awesome as that video that will help bring these forward, that would be an awesome start. And I'm going to maintain this Twitter account for a while at least to keep posting these various things that keep coming to me that I would love went to all of you. And I would love it if you would all join me, and that's it. Thanks. Right. If anybody has any questions, we just got like 2 minutes. It's not a big Q&A topic. All right, thanks. I would love to see you all online on the 13th.